Go ahead and say what you want to say.
So there's going to be a surprise at the end too.
So he says it's going to be a surprise at the end. Well, this is part three and the final to The Hive. So this has been my favorite story so far. I do like the story with the plantation, Mina and Quentin. So Chrissy is heading down the hallway. The fire alarm has just went off at the Hive Mental Institute. And as she's going down the hallway, she hears Sam, one of the men, permanent residents of the institute, he's whispering her to come down the hallway. So Chris is a little nervous, so she quickly looks to the right and she looks up ahead and she sees the guard face is still, you know, forward. Yeah, I don't know if they're guards or orderly. Same thing, girl. Kind of same thing. So she dashes really quick and follows Sam. She's like, Sam. And he turns around smiling, holding his britches, or holding his pants. I'm so country. He turns around smiling, holding his pants. He's like, yeah. She's like, Sam, are you the cause of all this? Did you pull one of the fire alarms? He shakes his head, yeah, I did. Like, he's proud of it, child. He's like, yeah, I did. She's like, what did you do this for? So he grabs her hand and starts pulling her towards the stairs, and they're now going downstairs. And so they go down two flights of stairs. Finally, they're at the bottom level where they do all of the, I guess you call it the lower level, where they do deliveries, you know, big truck deliveries and stuff. What? So Chris is like, where are you taking me? He's like, we gotta get out of here, girl. So Chris is like, oh my God. She's thinking to herself, oh my God, he was serious? After all this time, I mean, every other day when she would see him in the rec room, he talking about escaping. And this time, he really trying to do it. So they finally get down to the lower level. And when they turn the corner, Chrissy sees one of the orderlies on the floor, on the ground, clutching his chest. And it's one of the elderly orderlies, Mr. Chester. Chester had always been so kind to Chrissy, even when he was administering her, you know, a medication and a syringe, he was always very gentle with her. And so Chrissy's like, oh my God, Mr. Chester? And so Sam went past him and then turned around and said he never should have put up a fight. And that's when Chrissy was like, Sam, you did this to Mr. Chester? And that's when she could hear Chester on the ground kind of moan, and he lifts his hand and he says, Chris. She's like, oh my God. So she kneels down and she tries to put pressure on his wound. Sam had somehow stabbed him in the chest, I call it. That's when Sam opens up the door, the outside door that leads to, you know, wherever they do all the deliveries and stuff. And so he's like, okay, come on now, Chrissy. And so Chrissy is still on the ground, okay, kneeling next to Mr. Chester with her hands on his chest. And she looks up at Sam. She's like, this isn't right. This isn't right, Sam. I can't do it. And that's when Sam, something changed in his eyes, and he looks very angry at her. He walks a little bit towards Chrissy, and then he looks back and he decides against it, and she sees him, runs out. She's holding pressure down on his chest still, and that's when she looks around and she sees his walkie-talkie, and she picks it up and she's like, hello, hello. She finally hears a male voice that says, who's this? She's like, it's Chrissy. And she's like, well, there's been an accident. Please, you guys, someone needs to come down here. We need help on the lower level. So that's when the voice said, we'll be down there immediately. 5 minutes later, Chrissy can hear footsteps running down the stairs. And so about three of the guards came down and they ushered her out the way. And they're tending to Mr. Chester to make sure that he gets medical help, right? So it's a long night, y'all. They have to count to see, you know, who's missing. And sure enough, Chrissy let them know. She said Sam went out. And so eventually, like 3 hours after the incident, everyone gets back into their rooms. They shut down. The next morning, you know, things are a little uneasy. She's brought in to be interviewed. They want to make sure that she had nothing to do with it. You know, and she's very adamant. She's like, look, no, I had no idea. And so they said, you had no prior knowledge. They asked her, excuse me. So you had no prior knowledge that Sam was going to break out. Well, she said, well, Sam is always talking about breaking out, but I never take him serious. And so, you know, they're thinking about it, but Thankfully, Chester put in a good word for her and said that she stayed there even though Sam was trying to convince her to leave. She stayed there next to him and even called for help. So, 2 or 3 more weeks go by, you guys. And so Chrissy is up for a early release. And it is approved and everything because she's been on great behavior. She hasn't had any outbursts. She's been taking her medication, going to group therapy, and showing the bravery that she had exhibited and ensuring that Chester got help. You know, calling for help with the other guard. She didn't have to do that. She could have easily followed Sam's butt outside. By the way, they never find Sam, child. So anyway, Chrissy is released to a family friend that she's known since she was a girl, who knows all about her, you know, all the problems she had in the past, and who's able to help her. A couple of years go by, y'all, like 3 or 4 years go by, and Chrissy finally, you know, she gets a job at a local department store. She starts making money. She gets her own little small apartment. She has her small little cat that she got from Petco or something. You know, she has a little pet, a little companion. And so she, you know, continues working, and she eventually meets someone at the job, a nice gentleman. She noticed him. He was very nicely dressed, and they eventually start dating. I'm going to fast forward this because this is the very last one, okay? They eventually start dating, get engaged, and they get married. Okay, so another year or two goes in, and it's the week of their anniversary. Okay, and things are going well. Chrissy has decided she wants to make a dinner for her husband as a surprise, and she bought him a watch. So not only are they celebrating their second year anniversary, but they're celebrating her husband's promotion. Okay, but Chrissy has been a little uneasy because for the past 3 or 4 months, she's been getting anonymous calls on her cell phone. Her husband suggested that she change her phone number. She's like, no, I'm not changing my number. Then she started noticing things going missing around the house or things being moved. And she was sure she wasn't the one. She knows her husband wasn't the one. So now she's thinking, is there someone coming into our house? She gets security, extra security, you know, put in. They have video surveillance. She is meticulous about looking at the videos, you know, on a weekly basis. She sees nothing on the camera, nothing out of the ordinary. So the night comes up for her husband's anniversary, right? And she's preparing dinner. And that's when she hears a knock at the door. Goes to the front door, opens it up, and look who's standing in front of her. She cannot believe it. It is Cora, Miss Cora from the mental institution. And Chrissy's like, she said, are you gonna let me in, child, or I'm gonna freeze out here? And so Chrissy kind of shook her head, like, to make sure she wasn't seeing anything. She's like, of course, come on in, Miss Cora. And so Chrissy turns around and looks at her. She's like, so how are you here? Miss Cora turned around. She said, well, I guess after 25 years, they figured I wasn't a threat anymore. I'm too old and fat to get a fourth husband anyway. And so that's when Miss Cora said, it sure does smell good in here. Am I interrupting something? And so Chrissy's still shocked that they let Miss Cora out. She's like, no, I'm just preparing dinner. It's my husband and I. Second year anniversary. That's when Miss Cora's eyes lit up. She's like, oh, you married? She said, yes, ma'am. I've been married, you know, like I said, it's our second year anniversary. So she's like, could you just come in here, Miss Cora? I'm just preparing dinner. So Miss Cora follows her, and they start, you know, preparing dinner together. And so that's when Chrissy turns around. She said, look, Miss Cora, my husband knows about my, you know, my husband knows that I've had issues in the past, but he has no idea that I stayed at the mental institution for a month. So you're going to be my Aunt Cora. And that's when Miss Cora said, of course, darling, I'm Aunt Cora to everybody. So Chrissy said, good. She said, yeah, so you'll just be my Aunt Cora. So they finished preparing dinner together, child. Her husband ends up coming home at 6, and sure enough, they played the part. You know, Chrissy introduced Cora as Aunt Cora, and Cora played, you know, Cora's chatterbox, chatter. She's only been out for a few months, but she's still talking to anyone who will listen. So they sit down to have dinner, and Cora starts talking. She starts revealing some stories and some information that Chrissy had confided to her in secrecy. That's when she was like, her husband was kind of giving her some looks, but he was laughing, you know, some crazy looks, but he was laughing, thinking it was all, he couldn't tell if Miss Cora was serious or not, basically. And so finally, Chrissy turns around to Miss Cora. She said, "Could you excuse us for a second, Miss Aunt Cora?" Sorry. So she's like, "Yeah, darling, that's fine." Cora gets her husband and she walks into, you know, she takes him to the kitchen. She's whispering to him. She's like, "Look, honey, I'm so sorry about this. My Aunt Cora came in unannounced. As soon as dinner is done, I'll get rid of her." And that's when her husband looked at her kind of surprised. He's like, "It's no problem. I think she's a riot." And then he starts coughing. He's like, he's like, "I think she's survived. There's no..." He's like, and she's looking at him. Chrissy's looking at him concerned. She's like, "Are you okay? Do you need some water?" He's like, "No, my throat just feels a little... It's hard to breathe suddenly." And she's like, "Are you okay?" And all of a sudden, y'all, he grasps his throat and he collapsed, right? She could hear footsteps behind her. "Girl, let me find something. All I have is this Dairy Queen cup." Miss Cora in the doorway looking down at her husband clutching his throat. She's like, "About time." And so Chrissy's like, "You did this?" And Miss Cora said, "Yeah, honey. Happy anniversary." Chrissy is shocked. She pushes Miss Cora out the way, finds her cell phone, right, and dials 911. As Chrissy's on the phone with 911, Miss Cora escapes, child. She leaves. So they rush her husband to the hospital. It's okay. They catch it in time. So Chrissy is taken by the detectives. They get her, you know, they interview her to see what happened. And so Chrissy goes on to describe how Miss Cora came in. She wasn't aware that she was released. And she was assisting her with cooking dinner. And she's assumed that she put something into her husband's meal to make him sick. That's when there's a knock at the door, and that's when the one of the detectives get up and he motions for the other detective to come out. There's Dr. Gray standing there, and she's like, "Can I speak with you for a second?" They say, "Yeah, what's going on?" Finishing up the interview with Chrissy, and from what we understand, you know, one of your other patients, Cora, was released and put, and that's when Dr. Gray, she said, "There is no Cora, technically." And so they're like, "Excuse me?" So Dr. Ray said, "Well, Chrissy suffers from dissociative identity disorder, and Cora is actually one of her personalities." That's when the detective turns around and says, "Well, I'll be damned. She could have fooled me." And so they all turned around. They're in one of those rooms, y'all, where you can see the person on the other side, but they can't see you, girl. I don't know, a reversible mirror. They see Chrissy at the table sitting like this with her hands in front of her. In Chrissy's mind, she sees CJ to her right and then Miss Cora to her left, and they're all looking. So that is it, y'all. That is the final of The Hive. I hope you enjoyed this. Now, I hope y'all realize that she had three personalities. CJ was the younger version of her, Chrissy, who was the current version, and then Cora, which is the future version. Now, did you notice that all three of her personalities' names start with the same, with a C, basically the same initial? Okay, that was the giveaway. So yeah, unfortunately, Chrissy ended up going back to the Hive Institute, and she became a permanent resident. So that is it, y'all. Hope you enjoyed this one. Take care. Bye.